Martin, chef and unreserved petrol head. Now I'm going to retrace the steps of one of my all-time heroes, 70s F1 legend, Sir Jackie Stewart.
I'm Jackie Stewart, and I'm a racing driver.
I attempted to drive just like Jackie. Smooth, smooth, smooth. Right on the limit. I'll discover a tale of triumph.
It puts Jackie Stewart amongst the all-time greats.
And tragedy.
It was in the fifth lap, but something went wrong.
I was in tears when I put my visor down.
Jackie Stewart was an icon to a generation.
Jackie Stewart's sunglasses, £2.95.
Who changed motorsport forever.
The most important thing to me is to live to be a very old man.
And now we're going to experience the Jackie Stewart story. From the driver's seat.
For a cook, you're doing very well.
I'll do all right.
Since becoming a head chef in my early 20s, there's always been something else in the back of my mind. Cars. Pretty sure I'm a petrol head. I've got olive oil through this vein, and I think I've got petrol running around this vein. Motor vehicles are a huge part of my life. I like model cars. When I bought this house, it was a small little sort of two-bedroom bungalow. One of my idols there, the legend, Steve McQueen. Bedroom bike. I actually didn't live in the house because the first thing I built was the garages. Starting to get into the boys' room now. The garages had underfloor heating, they were air conditioned, fuel pumps here, Nelson Piquet's helmet, classic. I was having a bath with a measuring jug to wash my hair. Rolls Royce Phantom Coupe, one of my pride and joys, 288 GTO, 1985. And I lived in that for 7 years while the cars were living in luxury. But, you know, for me, I'm in a dream. Love this car. You can always hear the turbo whining. To me, the 1960s, 1970s for Formula One was a magical era. But when you're looking back at those old races, these cars were like sideways most of the time. You know, proper driving. I think out of that era came huge legends, the most famous of which is, of course, Sir Jackie Stewart.
Nobody has ever seen the finish of a motor race like that.
Jackie Stewart racing towards the finishing line.
In my opinion, Jackie Stewart is the greatest person in the history of motorsport.
I think most people would regard Jackie as the master of the art.
Just look at what he has done.
Sir Jackie Stewart is a three-time Formula One world champion.
It's Jackie Stewart!
His high-profile safety campaign changed the sport forever.
If I did not prepare myself for an accident, I think I'd be a fool.
I think we look back on his legacy as being the first person to be brave enough to stand up and say, this is not right.
For all of Jackie's clever thinking, there underlies a tremendous driving talent.
With the 70s icon as my guide, now I'm going to retrace his steps before driving his legendary Tyrrell Formula One car for myself. To be honest, I'm actually quite nervous. For God's sake, I've got pictures of him on the wall. You know, you might think I'm a stalker, but it'd be a fascinating insight, I think, into what it takes to be a racing driver.
It's here to see Jackie Stewart.
I'm meeting Sir Jackie for the very first time at his 120-acre property in Buckinghamshire. He's obviously come a long way from his days working on the forecourt of his parents' garage.
Ah, hi, James.
Sir Jackie, lovely to meet you.
Well, welcome to Clayton House.
Thank you very much. Once the fastest of his generation, Jackie now leads a more sedate life. Like the cows. First, we're headed to Jackie's farm, which, like any agricultural storage facility, is packed full of F1 cars from his days as team manager. And some of the silverware from his 27 wins
a record that stood for 14 years.
And this is just a small selection of what you've got.
I gave all my big ones away. That one there is when I won the Nürburgring by 4 minutes in a very wet and foggy day. So that might be my most cherished.
Nürburgring is what was it then, 13 miles?
14.7 miles around.
180 odd corners or something?
187 corners, yeah. For a cook, you're doing very well.
I do all right. Next, Jackie wanted me to meet his wife, Helen, a woman to whom he attributes much of his success.
Helen, this is James.
Hi there, Lou, Helen. Great to see you. Jackie has been with Helen since the tender age of 18.
So, press that.
And they're still very much in love.
Shut up. When Helen and I met, I walked in and there was Helen, and there was a number playing when that happened, and we'll never forget it. It was Love Letters in the Sand.
There can't be that many jet-setting icons with 50-year marriages. But then Jackie Stewart isn't your typical racing legend. The journey that you went on, what was that moment like when he won the Formula One World Championship for the first time?
I couldn't believe it, because I was so proud of him anyway, and the fact this had happened to us.
I mean, you were an integral part of to Jackie's career, because...
Well, without me, he wouldn't be world champion.
But also, you were one of the first pit girls, you were there timing, you were there at all the races. You were looking great on the side of the pits.
Oh yeah, but that was the case. They were very exciting, colourful, glamorous period of motorsport.
He asked my advice on, should he keep his hair long?
I like the sideburns.
Yeah.
And the sideburns got longer, and the longer they got, the faster I got.
Wasn't the helmet your idea, the race helmet with the tartan?
The tartan was. We're both very strong Scots, and Helen got out a sort of silk tartan band.
And it wouldn't go very round, it was a little bit at the back.
Right.
We couldn't afford that much more.
The Scottish thing, it was a big deal.
Jackie raced during a golden era. He and Helen were members of a Formula One Rat Pack, a handful of superstars who shared a closeness that would be unthinkable today.
There was a great camaraderie and a great group of people. Graham Hill, one of the funniest men you could ever have. Jim Clark, one of the most introverted but genuine men you would have ever known. Jochen, most exciting. And we all lived together, and with that, so many people were getting killed, and therefore people acted in a different way. I mean, one year we had in 4 consecutive months somebody die, and that was the most difficult time for Helen, because all the wives hung out together, and we had 2 little boys. That was my biggest fear, that something would happen and Helen would be left with them.
Paul came to me one day and says, "Mummy, when's Daddy going to die?"
Really?
And I said, "Who told you that?" And he said, "School." I said, "Well, let's just say we pray and hope it doesn't."
That really hurt me.
Yeah.
And I said, "Look, I'm very careful. I didn't take any chances, and I've got great people looking after me." The reality was, you know, I was awfully safety conscious. I think the closeness we had in those days has washed through all our life, where we've been together for such a long time, and the boys have grown up healthy, and we've now got 9 grandchildren from 2 boys. Not bad batting average.
But I wanted to go back to the very start of the story, and I was about to discover that Jackie's love of cars began on the forecourt of his parents' garage.
Well, this is something special.
Right.
My mother had an Austin Atlantic. It was blue.
Right.
And nobody else had them. Can you imagine, Scotland?
I'd never seen one before.
It was a way of ahead of its time. There we are. Good.
And we're off.
Yeah.
Growing up, Jackie couldn't wait to join the family business as an apprentice mechanic. After all, his school years were the most difficult of his life.
When I was 15, left school with a dyslexic problem. I was a disaster at school. When you can't keep up with the rest of your friends, it's not a nice thing. You're called stupid, dumb and thick by your teachers, and that was a fact. I had no self-respect, I had no esteem. I was totally complexed. I mean, I was bitter and twisted that I was so much of a failure inside of me. So I had to prove myself, I suppose, looking back now.
And prove himself he did, but not behind the wheel.
There we are, all in one piece.
It was on the shooting range that Jackie first put his brilliant hand-eye coordination to good use.
And I'll take my... Right, when I was 14 and a half, I really started to shoot. And my first competition I went into, I won. Shooting was just turned my life right around. I mean, to be good at something, you know, to win and to be applauded was a completely new experience for me.
In fact, he was so good, he was a member of the Scottish shooting team.
Whoa. Now, the idea is to try and make it just like that.
It turns out that dyslexia, something we both suffer from, drove Jackie to succeed.
To this day, I can't recite the alphabet. I was 42 when I was assessed and told I was dyslexic. And it was like I was saved from drowning.
Because I was 36 when it happened to me.
Well,
yeah.
There you are. You know, the great thing about being a dyslexic for both of us, and surely it's helped you, you find other ways of doing things.
I got into food because I felt that I could cook.
Yeah.
Whoa!
Behind that.
That was a miss, I'll let you have a go.
There you go. Whoa.
That was dust.
Yes.
You're pretty good at this, aren't you?
A bit lucky sometimes. My shooting life was hugely important to my motor racing life. To try and avoid a miss, I'd get myself ready, I'd get myself relaxed, I would breathe correctly, and then I would go for the target. So you remove emotion. That's what I did while shooting, and I learned that from shooting. I won most of my races in the first five laps, because everybody else was all wound up. Oh, you were a bit late on that one.
The personality of Jackie really, really has come out today, and you can understand why he stood out in amongst others. The house that he's got, the lifestyle that he's got, that's been hard earned. He's probably one of the most driven people I've ever met. Shooting provided Jackie with success, but his love of cars soon became too much to ignore. In 1962, a customer at his parents' garage offered him a test run in a sports car. He posted a time that was so impressive, he attracted the attention of talent spotter Ken Tyrrell.
I heard that he'd been driving very quickly, and I invited him around to drive my Formula 3 car. And he put up such a terrific performance in that car that there wasn't any doubt in my mind then that he was going to be a very fine driver indeed.
Well, that was a very big break. That was a sort of rocket ship into Formula 2 and then Formula 1.
Right.
It was like I was his son almost.
What did your mum think when you went back that day and said, I want to race?
Oh, that was a disaster. I was entering under the name of Ann Other, so that my mother wouldn't find out.
Right. Would have happened if she'd have found out?
I don't know. I hate to think. But she never, ever recognised I was a racing driver. And then I won the World Championship. Not a word. No recognition of that. And when I retired, she looks at me and she says, you're well out of it. And that was it.
And driving a BRM was the up-and-coming Jackie Stewart. After winning the F3 Championship, Jackie was signed to BRM as an F1 driver in 1965. His teammate, world champion, Graham Hill.
Was an ideal opportunity to go up against someone who was extremely well regarded.
Jackie learned a lot
from my dad about how to become a professional racing driver.
BRM's first and second.
And although they were in mortal combat in races, the relationship between my dad and Jackie was pretty good.
But I also like him as a friend too.
There's a good deal of clowning about before BRM goes on to win once again.
There was no, he's my number two, I'm the number one, you just sit back and watch. None of that.
Jackie Stewart, fast asleep in front of the BRM.
It was in the Italian Grand Prix that Graham Hill's number two first showed he had the potential to be number one.
It was a group of us, and eventually we drew away from some of them.
Clark Lotus let him down, and he had to retire.
And it was left with Graham and I with quite a few laps still to go.
This was the chance for the BRMs to get their own back. Jackie Stewart in one of them.
And he and Graham had a real old tear-up that just went on and on and on.
The two of them were racing hard for that Monza victory.
We were given a signal by Tony Rudd, the team manager, ease off, because we had such a big lead. And yet we were actually going as fast, if not faster. In the end, Graham made a mistake. I went through on the inside and took about a 3-second lead.
Jackie Stewart in one of them brought us a fantastically narrow win, beating Hill in the other BRM by just over 3 seconds.
And it was Jackie who came out on top that day at Monza and took his first ever Grand Prix win.
The Italian crowd is the most passionate crowd in the world, and they stream onto the racetrack and give you such a welcome and such recognition. Graham was fantastic. Not once did he complain, not once did he have a cross word with me. And it must have been frustrating for him, because in quite a few occasions I would be quicker than him.
Very soon I'll be strapping myself into Jackie's 1973 Tyrrell F1 car, and I was feeling a little unprepared. So I'd arranged to meet 1979 world champion Jody Scheckter for some extra tuition.
All right, Jody.
James.
So how do I begin to learn how to drive like Sir Jackie Stewart?
Well, he's known for his smooth driving.
Yeah.
The theory behind that is you've got so much traction on your tyres. You got to keep it on the maximum of that tyre the whole way around.
I wasn't quite sure what Jody was talking about.
The sideway movement.
But I was starting to realise that there was more to driving fast than meets the eye.
You're getting your maximum traction out that way.
Right.
The proof would be my driving. Am I smooth enough to emulate Jackie? I'm no stranger to track days, but this was different. Had a world champion to impress, and a data logging computer tracking my every move.
Straight hard, straight line.
Back in the pits, Jody and John the Boffin were analysing my lap.
Right, come up with that, so we can look at your line through the different corners. Yeah. So for example, on this chicane, you could probably get closer to the edge to come out of the corner quicker there.
If I was going to improve, I'd need to take some tips from my hero. So we watched Jackie's smooth driving in action.
You can see you're actually just doing very, very little movements in our steering wheel.
But the best way was smooth, there's no question about that.
Jackie believed his way of driving was safe and efficient, and developed a way of teaching it to the man on the street.
So we take off from the line as smoothly and as cleanly as we can. The question is to keep the ball in the dish all of the time, going through all of the corners.
Smoother driving is the best way of driving.
Thankfully, Jody had lined up a modern-day equivalent of Jackie's contraption.
So what's the plan?
Okay, so you've got to go through these pylons.
Yeah.
And you've got to keep the orange in there. And you've got to be like Jackie Stewart. Okay.
It's actually not as easy as it looks.
No, I think it is. Yeah. Come on, you got to get smoother than that. Jackie would have been much smoother.
And the faster Jody made me go, the more difficult it was to stay smooth.
You having a laugh?
Yeah, I'll have an orange while she's waiting there.
It's weird, isn't it? Your eye line, first of all, goes to this and keeping it in the pan. But then you become much smoother because you're not concentrating on it, if that makes sense.
Much faster, that's good.
After what seemed like hours of patient tuition, I got it. Yes!
Well done.
Yes! Get in there.
Well done, man. That's a lot better.
Well, I'm hoping this orange has improved my lap time. Fingers crossed for the next lap. The onboard computer would compare this lap time with my last. But I was busy concentrating on driving like Jackie Stewart.
That's 110 mile an hour on that corner.
Smooth.
Okay, look out the turning point. Feels so much quicker. Power out, that feels wicked. I'm using gears that I never lived in before. So much quicker at the exit.
It certainly felt good.
That showing the delta time, so it's half a second up.
But would the data show I was a smoother driver? So how do you think it is between the one that I did this morning?
No, I think the impressive part, you first saw you were 3 and something seconds quicker, and then also you were very smooth.
So what about conveying this? Because it's a different thing driving one of these to driving one of the old Formula One cars.
Well, you know, the fundamentals are saying you've got to get to the limit of the car.
Yeah.
And it'll be harder to get to the limit of a car on a faster car.
But what about impressing Sir Jackie?
Well, that's a hard one. But, you know, it's up to you. I think he'll if you do well, he'll let you know.
And into the lead, Jackie Stewart, BRM number 12.
Jackie's second season as a Formula One driver couldn't have started better.
With Jackie Stewart the winner on the road to the championship.
Now back to Spa for the closing stage.
Having won the first race at Monaco, he arrived in Belgium with high hopes.
Completing the front lane, Jackie took the 40.
But it was a race that would change everything for Jackie.
Motor racing is dangerous. There's a mystique about danger. There's an attraction. But you don't want to be having accidents. To finish first you must finish.
But Spa 1966 was a race Jackie was never to finish.
And that's all we've seen. Only 6 cars have gone through at the end of the first lap.
I had no idea what had happened to Jackie. But another 2 wives, one drowned about half a bottle of whiskey, one went hysterical because they had no idea what happened.
The drivers encountered a fierce rainstorm at the 145 mile an hour corner at the bottom of the hill, and that was where Graham Hill saw in the field the other BRM, that of Jackie Stewart, upside down with Jackie still in it.
Jackie bounced off a wall off the front of a cottage and landed with his BRM literally banana-shaped around him.
And I was soaked in fuel, high-octane aviation fuel in those days. It was burning my skin right off me. And there was nobody there. No marshals, no help.
He was in his own bomb. But that day wasn't going to be his 10th of a second. It just wasn't.
And that was the day that he formulated his creed that he was paid to show his skill and not to show his bravery.
Despite his experience at Spa, life was good for Jackie. He had become a key part of the racing fraternity and was best friends with Scottish ace Jim Clark.
He was the best driver I ever raced against.
I think it's impossible to overemphasize just how important Jimmy Clark was to Jackie. You know, they even shared a flat together at one point.
The fellow Scot took Jackie under his wing and helped him adjust to life in Formula One.
I learned so much from Jim Clark, seeing him, how he dressed, how he ate, how he talked, how he wasn't infatuated by his own success. And I spent my life as a professional racing driver trying to do just that.
Jackie was hungry for the same success as his friend Jim, but his BRM car was becoming less and less competitive. To win a world title, he needed to be in a better vehicle. Fortunately, he was approached by the man who first discovered him, Ken Tyrrell.
Ken tapped him on the shoulder one day and said, "Why don't you drive for me next year?"
He said, "Ken, you don't have a racing team, you don't have Formula One." He said, "But what if I had?" I said, "Well, then we could talk about it."
They never actually signed a contract between the two of them. They shook hands on it, and that became their contract.
And we just had a gentleman's understanding.
Tyrrell sourced a car that would suit the Scot and built a team around him. Jackie's future was full of promise, but his commitment to racing was about to be put under intense emotional strain.
It was in the fifth lap that something went wrong. Clark's car had not reappeared in front of the timekeeper.
Jim Clark ran off the road, hit a tree, and suffered unsurvivable head injuries, and the car was smashed to pieces and broken in two.
Helen was the one who broke the news to Jackie, and Jackie recalls just sobbing his heart out.
If Jim Clark could die, anybody could die. He would have been the last person we would have expected to lose in a race car.
Jackie responded to the death of his hero in the only way he knew how. With the greatest performance of his entire life.
You could call it the Grand Prix that nearly got lost. Lost in fog and torrential rain, 3,000 feet up in the Eiffel Mountain.
They were conditions in which a race would not even be started these days. And it's one of the great motor racing drives of all time.
You beat everybody by almost a lap. And you don't do that unless you're a real virtuoso, one of the real greats.
Coming driving in Jackie Stewart, number 6 in a Metro Ford, was piloting his car as though he had built-in radar.
When they're in those conditions, and to show such enormous balls in driving at that rate, just putting onto a plane that was so far ahead of everybody else, it was just untouchable. And it's one that justified his stance on safety in later years, because nobody could accuse him of being chicken.
Stewart took the chicken flag at an average speed of 86.82 miles an hour.
Jackie and Team Tyrrell had shown the world what they were capable of. But many people doubted that a new team could win the 1969 world title.
He was a world champion in the making, but he hadn't done it yet. So for Jackie Stewart to take the gamble and say, "Yeah, you know what, I'm going to go with Ken Tyrrell and his new team," that was a gamble, but it paid off big time.
This left the field wide open for Jackie Stewart in his Anglo-French Matra 4.
He had an overpowering effect on my way of thinking, my preparation, my commitment.
The man with his sights set on the 1969 Drivers' Championship.
And to allow my natural ability to be able to display itself.
And Jackie Stewart fulfills the promise that talent spotter Ken Tyrrell saw in him.
1969, I think I won 6 Grand Prix. I think 4 of them back to back.
Ken Stewart holds the line on this the last lap. Somebody is challenging his wrist going through. It's over the line together. And it's almost a dead heat. It's Jackie Stewart. Nobody has ever seen the finish of a motor race like that.
the South African Grand Prix, the Spanish, the Dutch, the French, the German, and finally Monza, had clinched the championship and written a cheque for £100,000 in prize money.
After a triumphant season, Jackie won his first world title, aged just 29.
Canto and the mechanics, the Matra designers and everyone else really put the thing together in a very good package. Really, it was only left for me to drive the car because I think we had a pretty perfect setup.
I almost inherited the Jim Clark position as the leader within Formula One.
15 years ago, Jackie Stewart got Fangio's autograph. Now he's the idol, one of the new generation making fortunes in sport.
He's the best racing driver driving today. As a businessman, I think he may be even better.
By the end of the 60s, Jackie had hit the big time. The Stewarts moved to Geneva, where they enjoyed an idyllic lifestyle. Something I've come to the Alps to get a taste of.
Well, I have a wee surprise for you. I'm going to give you a taste of Jackie Stewart's jet set period of the early 70s. Right there.
Oh, look at this.
De Tomaso Pantera.
This exotic supercar was the stuff of many a boyhood fantasy. And when Jackie's sponsor Ford bought the Italian manufacturer, he was the recipient of a new company car.
For Jackie Stewart, getting home is a treat.
Well, you can see it's a good looker, but let's go for a spin up in the Alps and then you can drive it. Give you a bit of reminiscence to the swinging 70s as it really was.
Oh, thank you. This is for your dream, this.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Kind of had an image and marketed that image.
Well, I guess I was the first, what I would call, truly commercial sportsman, particularly in motorsport. By the time I was threatening the world championship, suddenly advertising arrived.
Yeah.
And quickly when motorsport from the sportsperson is that if you're a football player, there's the boots and the strip.
Things like the sunglasses, the hat, the image, everything, the tartan.
Oh, it was lifestyle too, you must remember. It was a swingy 60s to begin with. The lifestyle was synonymous with money. I was seeing other, well, I'd say rich people living a rich style. To afford that, you couldn't do it just by driving cars. You had to have outside commercial relationships. Business was more different than sport. I love doing deals. I get as much satisfaction in my business as I ever love my business. You've got to pay great attention to detail.
And that attention to detail, somebody told me that it came down to what you were wearing. Didn't you have a shirt with a shorter sleeve?
No, it was wider, but I'm wearing one now.
Yeah.
My left cuff is wider than my right cuff, so that if I'm photographed, the watch is visible.
And it was Jackie's financial nous that drove the decision for the family to leave their UK home and relocate to Switzerland.
I left in 1968. I had to pay 93% tax. As a racing driver, the chances are I was going to be killed. Helen would have had nothing left. It was a big move, very unpopular in the Glasgow Herald, the Daily Record, the Scotsman newspapers. It still isn't popular today.
And with that, it was time to fulfill my childhood fantasy and drive the Pantera.
Oh, we've got the hat off.
I've got this for you.
Look at that.
How was that good?
Wow, that looks like a...
All the sideburns
a 70s child. And the shades.
I feel as if I'm in the zone.
Oh, wow.
This is what started my love of cars. This car.
Sometimes, though, it's better not to fulfill your dreams.
It's weird, the seatbelt's flapping around. Yeah, pretty pointless, to be honest.
Ever the gentleman, Jackie tried to distract me.
Well, look at this. This thing is wonderful. Look at that old castle on the way to the
top. As much as I love the countryside, I'm just concentrating on what's in front of me.
Good.
Three times Formula One world champion sat next to me.
Yeah. Well, I'm well braced.
Who am I well braced? You need to be well insured, that's the thing.
Off the power, on the brakes.
Steering.
Off the brakes. Gently, that's right. Oh, there we go. Sheer acceleration.
Jackie became motorsport's first millionaire. But he was about to learn that money in the bank wouldn't guarantee another world title.
The first race in the 1972 Grand Prix season.
The 70s began with Jackie Stewart as the reigning world champion, but the French company who built his winning car refused to supply Tyrrell for the new season. That meant they had to buy an off-the-shelf alternative.
The world champion's number on a march. A brand new body, Ford Cosworth engine.
Now Jackie had little chance of keeping up with Austrian star Jochen Rindt and his expertly engineered Lotus.
You've had a very good chance to look at the new cars on the track. Which of them impresses you most?
Actually, none of them impresses me very much because they're all the same.
As Jackie struggled in his slow, unreliable car, Rindt grew ever closer to the world title.
I think the fastest at the moment is certainly Jochen Rindt.
The Austrian ace now has a commanding lead of 20 points in the championship.
But despite their rivalry, Jackie and Helen were close friends with Jochen and his wife.
Jochen was great, and Nina was fantastic. She was one of the most beautiful women in the world. He was somebody who was an important part of my life, and one of the drivers I would have trusted under any circumstance.
Season ended in tragedy.
I literally was there by his side, I mean, literally. And they wouldn't admit that he had died because in Italy, had he died on the track, they would have had to cancel that Grand Prix for the weekend. I was in tears when I put my visor down. And I went out and I passed the spot that Jochen died, and then I got on it and I did the fastest lap I'd ever done.
But the death of the Austrian star was just one of many. In 1970, three drivers died in 3 months.
Jochen was in September, Piers Courage was in June, and so also was Bruce McLaren in June. And somehow or other, it was part and parcel of life at that time, and the shock, the despair, the grief will never be erased. Jochen, in fact, won the world championship in 1970, the first posthumous world champion ever.
That year, Jochen's wife Nina collected the world title on his behalf. Off the track, Jackie took his safety campaign to a whole new level.
You're all wearing seatbelts? You have to. It's entirely your responsibility.
The most important thing to me is to live to be a very old man. If I did not prepare myself for an accident by using the best helmet, the best clothes, the best thermal underwear, the best seatbelts, I think I would be irresponsible. I think I'd be a fool.
Crash barriers, runoff areas, and flameproof protection were just a few of the things that Jackie pushed for.
Terribly important that everyone pays the right amount of attention.
Everyone from car designers to track owners were at the receiving end of his battle for safety.
Jackie was not the most popular driver. Certainly not with some commentators who thought he was taking the masculinity out of the sport.
If these people are afraid of racing, we'll give up.
People thought Jackie Stewart was a wimp. The attitude in those days was, the throttle works both ways. If you're going too fast, then back off a bit.
But Jackie didn't stop at motorsport. He used his star profile to put safety on the agenda in every walk of life.
Now, I've lost friends very close to me,
and I tell you, it hits you very, very hard.
If you're walking on the pavement or crossing the road, I think you've got to give as much concentration to what you're doing as I have to when I'm driving my racing car.
But on the track, Jackie still had a job to do. And to make sure he had the right car to do it in, Ken Tyrrell commissioned his own Formula One vehicle.
Ken, without anybody knowing, got Derek Gardner, a wonderful designer, had designed this car in his own living room. I would go up secretly and get into his garage and get seat fittings for this car of the future.
The Tyrrell F1 car was ready for the 1971 season. But would the homemade car perform on the world stage?
Ben Stewart hadn't won a Grand Prix since his Spanish victory a year ago.
And sure enough, it came out immediately the front.
After five laps, Stewart took the lead, and there he stayed.
Six Grand Prix victories, won in the World Championship for the second time, and the manufacturer's title for Ken Tyrrell. And puts the name of Jackie Stewart firmly amongst the all-time greats of motor racing.
The Flying Scot was back, and in Monza, he was crowned double world champion.
Leaving aside your undisputed skill, damn it, what single factor do you think contributed towards your victories this year?
I think, again, my skill.
To drive Jackie's win in Tyrrell, I'll need to experience the extreme G-forces an F1 car can produce. And that's why I'm here, at the home of British motorsport.
One of my pet hates is a passenger in a fast car, so it'd be actually my idea of hell, being strapped into something that's super quick by a driver that I don't even know.
And of course, that's exactly what's going to happen in this hypersonic F1-style two-seater.
It's a bit basic.
There's not a lot of room in here.
I'm just wondering what that is. If it had one seat, then I'd be interested.
Well, I'm hoping the guy knows what he's doing.
He goes. I haven't ever seen a two-seater racing car like this before.
Hi James, I'm Jack. I'm 2012 British Formula 3 champion, and I'm your driver coach for the day.
And have you driven this before?
Our first time I drive will be you in a few moments.
You are having a laugh, aren't you?
It's only a racing car.
It's only a racing car? How old are you?
19.
19? Jack's a great kid, but he's a kid, you know. He probably still plays with Star Wars figures and Lego when he gets back home.
It's going to be interesting to see you try and get in the back, that's for sure.
Oh,
not nervous, are you?
Proper bricking it, to be honest, yeah.
Oh.
I'm not good as a passenger. I'm certainly not good sat in the back seat. And on that thing, you can't actually see anything in front of you. Yeah, I'm not really looking forward to it. Jeez. See, actually, this is quick enough, to be honest.
As we accelerated out of the pit lane, I braced myself for the physical forces that I know a Formula One car can generate. In the late 1960s, aerodynamics completely changed motorsport. Modern day F1 cars with their sharp nose and wings front and rear can be traced back to Jackie's day. The overall effect pushes the car to the tarmac, meaning it can corner at phenomenal speeds.
The G-force left the brake to the end, and the end, you're thick!
And as for Jack, my junior racer...
What a driver! Unbelievable!
That's enough for me. Slow down! Otherwise I'll phone his mother.
It ended up being an enjoyment, to be honest, an experience that I've never ever felt before in my life. I'd much rather be in the front seat than in the back seat. You've got, you know, twice as much horsepower in the Tyrrell as opposed to that thing, but it's going to be incredibly hard work.
The celebrity life. Stewart spends more time in the air than the South African Airways captain who flew him into Johannesburg.
By 1972, Jackie was a global superstar, but his relentless drive for success was pushing him over the edge.
This year was different somehow. I was very tired, I was very uptight, and I couldn't unwind.
I just destroyed myself health-wise. I was just burned out. I missed a few Grand Prix's, I lost the World Championship, I finished second in the World Championship that year. And then I thought I might retire because I was feeling so bad.
There's puddles around the track, the place is a mess.
Maybe in the wet you can accept that.
I should think I will be able to accept it.
Well, anyway.
April of 73, I made a complete decision that I was going to retire, but I would race until the end of the year for Ken's sake.
But Jackie made the decision, knowing he was handing over the reins to a safe pair of hands, his young understudy, Francois Sever.
For Jackie, there were two aims, I think, that year. To wrap up another title, to end on a high, but to give Francois that little leg up to make sure that he could continue in that vein for the Tyrrell family, which was so important to all of them.
And then, second, crushed. First with the left, the right one, under the...
Because I knew I was retiring, there was nothing that I kept back from Francois. He was a very attractive man for the ladies. He had unbelievable eyes, a great sense of humour. He had a fantastic physique, like a young fighting bull. And as a racing driver and as a teammate, I couldn't have had a better one.
There was an affection there, a genuine affection that Jackie had for Francois.
He was part of the Stewart family.
You would think that Jackie teaching me everything he knows, I will become another Jackie Stewart.
You did?
Well, but for the moment, I'm far to be as good as Jackie Stewart. So I'm Francois Sever.
Team Tyrrell had a bright future. All Jackie had to do was go out in style.
1973, we just couldn't do a thing wrong. They were like two brothers on the same team.
Jackie kept his decision to retire a secret and approached his final season with renewed vigour.
Jackie Stewart racing towards the finishing line. His teammate Sever second, a triumph for Stewart and the British Tyrrell fourth.
The end of that season was at Watkins Glen, and Jackie had already wrapped the championship up. That was just going to be his 100th race.
On Friday we practiced and we were quick. We looked like we could win the race.
On the eve of Jackie's final race, Ken Tyrrell came to him with a master plan.
Everybody would love it if you're leading the race and you move over and let Francois win. And I said, Ken, you know, you're asking a lot. This is my last race ever. If I can win the race, I'd love to. He said, yeah, but you'd be even bigger if you didn't.
Certainly there is no noise, and there is no cars coming back to the pit. François Sever was killed in an absolutely appalling accident.
I was one of the last to arrive, and there was debris everywhere, and François was still pretty much half in the car. I would hate for anybody to see that. I was so shocked by it, but then I was so angry that the sport could do this, and I stayed for what I thought was long enough, but looking back I wish I hadn't left when I did.
041 through the guardrail. No reason has been given for the accident.
Everybody in the team were terribly affected, naturally.
Jackie got together with Ken Tyrrell and they decided they were going to withdraw the team.
That was how it ended for Tyrrell that year, and certainly that's how Jackie Stewart's career ended.
He missed his 100th Grand Prix. He achieved his world championship for the third time, but he did it in very tragic circumstances.
I then said I was no longer going to be a racing driver. It was a decision I have never, never, ever regretted. I was never tempted ever to go back. It just never entered my head.
Years on, François has his own bench in the grounds of the Stewart's house, along with dozens of Jackie's fallen comrades.
It is very moving when you're here, because you look out and you just see benches, and that's a friend of yours that's died.
François Sever, he would have been the number one driver in 74. And I think he would have gone on to win the world championship. He was that good, you know, what should have been a terrific ending for him, because I think we could have won the race, and that was the end of that.
But Sever's death wasn't in vain. I'm at McLaren to meet a man who took Sever's place in the Tyrrell team, Jody Scheckter. Jody benefited firsthand from Jackie's safety crusade, which gained even more momentum once he retired.
But this is the car very similar to the one that you drove.
Just the same car as I drove.
Now, so much has changed since that crash of Sever. I mean, you were there, so you actually saw what happened.
I was on the scene, I tried to get him out, and, you know, he died, and I just remember, well, everything carried on, and I thought, well, no, but a guy's just died, you know?
Because you had a huge off in a car, not too dissimilar to this, didn't you?
Yeah. At Silverstone, yeah, I remember that, yeah.
Miraculously, no one was seriously hurt. The new breed of cars fulfilled their promise, and not one of them caught fire.
But, you know, if you look at the cars before, say when Jackie started, these are massive improvement. You know, Jackie's, if he gets into something, he doesn't stop. You know, I suppose that he talked so much, they just gave up.
So Jackie's tireless work transformed the sport, something that hits home when you look at Lewis Hamilton's car.
So it's not until you look at a modern Formula One car do you see all the safety features that were started to work on in the 70s.
It's gone a long, long way. I mean, if you go here, you just feel how solid it is compared to that car. You don't have to do much more. And this is all padding.
Yeah.
So that it's, you know, if you have a side crash, that's going to protect you.
Jackie Stewart was unique in motorsport because he really fought against the grain, whereas everybody else just got in a race car and took it for granted that these things happen. He was unique that he stood on his own at times, still does.
He moved it on more than anybody in the history of a motor racing. They are so much safer now.
The last person who was killed in a Formula One car was the great Ayrton Senna.
Senna, yeah, yeah.
Motorsport will always be inherently dangerous, but what Jackie Stewart has left is something that will be blue stamped throughout motorsport from now on.
And what he did was save people's lives. Before Sir Jackie and I parted company, there was one last thing for me to do. We were at Lake Como, which could only mean one thing. I'd be driving round Monza.
I have to say I want a little bit more of this lifestyle. But the problem is I've got to get in a Formula One car. To say that I'm not nervous is an understatement. I get to drive, you know, your 1973 winning Tyrrell.
Yeah, wonderful car. It's a very famous car. You'll like it to drive, but it's quite tricky. Quite a nervous car.
So Lake Como is a special place, and Monza has a huge stamp on your career.
You were always hyped up for Monza. Everybody gets wound up just because of the atmosphere. This was, for me, part of the build-up, part of the chemistry that allowed me to get rid of all that tension and get rid of all that expectation.
You brought your family here, you know, the kids are running around. You could have walked out that door and never seen them again.
Emotion's fantastic to get rid of. The car feels your nervousness if you have it.
The speeds that you're doing around Monza in the Tyrrell that I'll be driving, I mean, the top speed, what will you get out of it?
187, 188 mile an hour. We never quite cracked to 200.
So look at me, I'm not going to be doing it either.
Oh yes, you are.
I'm calm, I'm quite happy to sit here all day, to be honest, and leave the car for you lot.
So. Well, maybe I sort of felt like that too sometimes.
Unbelievably nervous, and to say that I'm not scared is a bit of an understatement. You know, I'm driving something that, you know, is a 1970s Formula One car, and they're inherently dangerous. A lot of people were killed on this track, and Francois was killed in this car. It fills me with trepidation, fear, excitement.
Wanna do that?
A little bit like that.
Just a bit.
Well, this is your baby for the day. You couldn't have any better.
Right,
in you go. Okay, both hands back. Yeah, that's it. Just slip right down.
Okay.
Right. Well, listen, I hope you enjoy it. It's a great car. Just take your time, particularly the first lap. A wee bit nervous, because to be in that car round Monza with so much history.
I'm actually at Monza.
You know, it's a big moat.
Jackie's advice was to tiptoe around the first chicane. Then it was time to open the Tyrrell up and find out just how magical this car really is.
Now you've got a few revs over, that's good.
This is the most amazing feeling. And the sun sets in the water. And this is the strength.
I'm going to go up the pit wall and see him through. Bump down
in a couple of gears now. One, two, three, three.
Second gear. Get it in there.
Into the first chicane, and then he's going to accelerate out of that. There he goes. Heading down towards the next chicane. He's going to go through in a bit of a dip underneath the bridge. Now he's going down the main straight. He looks good today, I think he's going out fine. Well, I've never even seen a turtle run around this racetrack. It's nice. I still love the sport. I absolutely love it. For all the bad things that have happened, there's 100 better things that have happened in many ways. And it still gives me enormous joy just to be around the cars and to be able to see somebody having that much pleasure out of it. It's, that itself is terrific.
Sun surrounded by petrol just makes you realise how great these guys were, you know?
I was in tears on the back straight as I was coming in. I didn't want to come in. I just want to keep going and going, round and round, and just incredible, absolutely incredible. Just let me sit here.
Good.
What an experience! If this is heaven, it's got a steering wheel and four tyres, and it's painted blue.
Popping out for a bite, Alice Roberts goes back in time to meet some Ice Age giants face to face. That's next. And hoping to strike it rich, Simon Reeve is on the search for gold and gets lucky in Australia at 9.